Hi, Beverly.
Hi.
This is Mary Dioma, and I'm talking with Beverly Brodsky.
Yes.
We met at the Orange County Ions meeting. Maybe we met before that. Anyway, when you came and you spoke and you told us your story. So, tell me about who you are and what you've done before, and then we'll go from there.
Okay. Well, at the time, my name was Beverly Singer, and I was a very troubled young person. I was 20 years old, and as to what I've done before my experience, I was just searching, and I wanted to find something that had meaning to me, and I found it in a very unusual way by having this motorcycle accident. Where I was struck by we were struck by a drunken driver, and I had I was a passenger on a motorcycle without a helmet, and I was thrown onto the highway and suffered dozens of broken bones in my head, and the skin was ripped off the right side of my face. And when the ambulance and the police got there, they were going to book the driver for homicide because they thought that there was no way I could survive such injuries. So I was taken to UCLA hospital, and for 2 weeks I was in a quasi coma. And my mother asked me to come home with her, but we had become estranged shortly before this happened, and she was on the East Coast, and I had just arrived in L.A. And so in 2 weeks, they released me from the hospital, and they told me they couldn't give me anything for pain, because anything they would give me would be addictive. And so I went home to the place where I was temporarily staying, and I was in such a state of despair because I was in terrible pain. I thought I would be maimed for life, and I had been an atheist, but I sort of considered myself an agnostic, as we all do when we're in the foxhole, so to speak. Mm-hmm. And I went to this place where I was staying, and I threw myself down on the bed, and I said this prayer from the very center of my being. I said, "Well, God, if you're out there, you can have me now, because I can't go on anymore." And I just really wanted to die. I just thought, that if I could be released from my life, all my problems would end. And with that prayer, I found myself rising up out of my body. And I was amazed, because here I was still me, And yet I wasn't my body. And all of that horrible pain in my head was gone. Oh, the pain. Oh, it was such a relief to be free of that. And then I saw on the ceiling of the room this radiant angel. And I didn't believe in angels. I thought they were like, you know, fairies in the fairy tales, or else decorations on top of Christmas trees. and I was Jewish, and, you know, I didn't realize that there were lots of stories about angels and Jewish tradition. But this angel was a man. I felt very strongly that this was a man. And he just glowed from within. He had he, like a lantern. He had this inner light that shined and just radiated his whole countenance. And then as I got closer to him, I recognized him, and I felt that I had known him, that I knew him now, you know, in the moment. And he took my hand. I was in this perfect body, as I had mentioned, and he was also in this etheric body. And so he took my hand such as it was, and we went flying out right through the window. And this didn't frighten me because it was like I'd always been flying through windows all my life. And below us was the beautiful Pacific Ocean. And but I wasn't looking down. I my attention was drawn to this dark space up above and to the right that we were flying into, and it was like heading into a portal to another dimension. And we went flying through, at some very rapid speed, through a very great distance, perhaps the whole physical universe. And then we came out on the other end, and suddenly this tiny pinpoint of light that I saw was right in front of me. And the angel was gone, but there before me was this living presence of the being of light. And this is where it's hard to find the words, but this being was all things that ever were, are, and will be, or can change in it. It had no gender, but I'll just say he, because that's the commonly preferred noun, and he also contained perfect justice, all of the answers to the big questions, that there was a reason, this I remember very strongly, that there was a reason for everything that we experience here, but it was something that I couldn't bring back to the extent that I knew it there. And also he contained all of knowledge, I think I mentioned this. And he was just loving me, completely perfect, unconditional love. And I thought, well, this isn't the guy on top of the Sistine Chapel, but I guess this must be God, because he was omnipotent, and everywhere present, and in all space and time. And I was very angry at God, and I had a few questions for him. The nature of this place is so different from what we experience here. Like, the intensity of it was like, it was like here we're a little candle, and when we're home, it was, felt like going home to the place that you've always known but forgot about. And it's just so perfect. And then you or I was like a sun. It was like so different from our muffled identity that we feel in this lifetime. And so I got to ask him all of my big questions. And the amazing thing was that I already knew the answers. There was a part of me that said, oh, yes, of course. How could I ever have forgotten that? And then I reached a stage where I had no more questions because I got it. I got the perfect knowledge. I understood how everything works. It was very simple there. I got the perfect knowledge, and it was very simple. And I don't know why we don't bring that back.
Oh, you couldn't bring it back.
Yeah. Maybe because the whole point of being behind the veil, as we are, is to have a little mystery. Or maybe our brains can't hold this knowledge. And it's anyhow, I do get a feeling when I feel something that I hear is true, something that I hear or read, I have a knowingness that that is part of the story. And I could share some of that.
Oh, yes.
Well, I believe that we plan our lives, and we have a soul family, and we have counselors, and we come together to accomplish certain goals. And so, and also groups can decide to leave the planet together, because I think that's what happened with the people in 9/11 or the people in Iraq. Or any tsunami or any tragedy where many people die, it's not by chance. I think everything is, you know, there is a free will. There is a clause, so to speak, in the sacred contract where we can, by free will, we can opt out of that agreement. And so it doesn't always...
Is it your lower self or your higher self that opts out? I mean, can your lower self call the orders, you know, make the choices, or is it some part of yourself that's the higher self that's making the decision?
I think that the higher self is in charge. That's why my lower self wouldn't have wanted to ever leave, but the higher self is responsible for those agreements and those contracts. So the higher self, if the person, like say there are all these stories about someone not going, who decided not to go, wasn't present at the time of these catastrophes, it's because there was something that had come up that their higher self had agreed to, that they had to live. And so so these are the things that really feel true to me.
So as you're going about life, you're getting clues by that feeling of what information was there. And so things come up, and you have that super feeling, and you're like, oh, yeah, that's part of it.
Yeah. And so in a way, it shows the truth of the saying that there are no accidents, there are no victims, only volunteers. But we came here to have these experiences that are our life's tragedies, you know, from a human perspective. or, you know, whatever, or ailments, suffering, losses. But we grow so much from, we're meant to grow so much from these things that happen to us. And it's something that souls can't do when they're on the spiritual, in the spiritual plane. We grow faster in the physical plane. I know it kind of really upsets my lower mind to say this, but...
that was my next question, is how hard has it been for you to integrate this level of truth with, you know, life? And
it's been very difficult. I can say more about my experience. After I accepted this, the being of light was trying to give me this love, and after I had my questions answered, I just really absorbed all that love. And then the Creator or God or whatever this being was took me on a tour of the universe. And I feel like I got to see all of his other children, like the stars and the planets and the galaxies and the comets. And, oh, it was so beautiful. The difference between what we see there and what we see, you know, in the Hubble telescope images is like we were just traveling at the speed of thought. So there were no distances, and there was no darkness. Nowhere was anything surrounded by darkness. Everything was more and more full and beautiful and alive, light. It was all radiant matter. So I got to see the rest of the universe, the 96% that we don't see, in its glory. And then we went into the center of this newly formed star. It seemed to be at the center of all things. And then as we went into this door, we went into this other portal, and all external objects vanished. And I was with the thought and the love of the being of light, although it was no longer a being and no longer having any light, and all things were there. That would be, it was like if we were going into what the Hindus call the night of Brahman, or the time before the Big Bang, or, you know, the time before let there be light, whatever your belief system, we went back, and the only reason that I bring this back was I remembered that I had been that girl who said that prayer on the bed and begging for God to take her. I had been Beverly, and yet here I was, like a drop of the wave of this cosmic void. And yet here I was, one with all things and with the Creator of all things. And this was so blissful. Oh, I can't find the words to say what bliss this was, the oneness. It is our birthright, but most people don't know it, that this is what we are. We are that light. We are that love. And and then without my asking for it, somehow I was back in that body, and I came to my normal waking consciousness, and the wisdom was gone, the universal wisdom. You know, it was like waking up from a dream, only it was much more intense than a dream could be. It was, you know, like I'm dreaming the rest of my life, 41 years since then. And, but that, I know that that was real. I've never doubted that that was real. And I had to sit down and reconsider everything I'd ever believed, because nobody had told me about this light and about how much we're loved. And that all these things that we, you know, we worry about, and you know, I was super shy and a real perfectionist. Everything had to be done just so. But, like, we are loved regardless of what we do. And we don't have to earn. We don't have to earn. It's like having a newborn baby with its mother. The mother loves that baby. It doesn't matter what the baby has done. We are so loved. And this was such a tremendous relief. And I had several miracles happen from my experience. The first was that for a period of about 6 months, I didn't feel any pain, because my feet barely touched the ground. The part of me that could feel pain was so much less than the part of me that was still in this oneness and bliss and knowledge. And and also I had certain things that came to me right away, like knowing that we live on and that there is no death. These were huge revelations for me. And also that there is a plan. And that everything is part of, there is both a universal plan, and as I spoke about before, there's a personal plan that we play our part in this universal drama. So in a way, I understand what Shakespeare said when he said, "All the world's a play, and we are the players of every part." Because in a sense, that's true.
Just like the analogy, that we are not only ourselves, but we're all the parts in the play.
Oh, yes, yes, because we are all one. That's kind of a primal truth. We're one with all the stars. And the animals and the earth and the other people that we're involved with, they're a part of us.
Yeah.
So, you know, some people get to play the part of the bad guy, and some people play the part of the hero and the heroine. At heart, we are that star stuff, that divine energy and light, and however much we forget it when we take on the mask, the role that we're playing in this lifetime, we are really, we're all a part of each other. And so I really think that the golden rule is literally true, and for people who have life reviews, which I didn't have in my NDE, but having studied it for 25 years and heard many people's life reviews, it seems that we are truly judged by our sins, and it's not like anyone external, you know, gets to judge us. We are, because our higher self is part of the divine consciousness, is a more full expression of the divine consciousness. So our higher selves understand this. That's why we feel when we do something that's wrong, we have a feeling like, oh gee, I really shouldn't be doing this. And there's a little voice in our head that says, stop. And I try as best I can to listen to that voice, because I know that that whatever I do, if I think I'm getting away with it, I won't get away. I really believe that we all will have a life review, and that's the purpose of this experience that we're having, you know, in this play. We're all going to get to judge ourselves as to how well, you know, how well we remember the lessons that we came to learn, and the truth of what we are. And I think it's really difficult for us in the West, in modern Western civilization, because we live in such a materialistic culture that denies all of this, that denies the basic facts that everyone else throughout all of time, every civilization has known this truth. That we are spiritual beings having a physical experience and not the opposite. And only Western civilization in the modern couple hundred years has denied this and has been teaching us that we are things, that we are objects, I-its. You know, we're not the I-thou. That I experienced in my NDE, where I it, and we treat the world and other people as if they are also things, and it's
I'm
really
not sure I got what you just said. The I what? We are not the I what?
We are not the I thou. The sacred. There is not this, in Western civilization, there's not this holiness in the encounter with the other. There is an I-it encounter. This comes from Martin Buber, wrote about this. And he really wasn't, he was a mystic of sorts. He was also a modern thinker. And we make everything into an object. And everyone into an object, and even ourselves. And we might have a pure relationship with a child or a pet, but the whole point of life seems to be to accumulate more objects, more stuff. And
have you been able to integrate your lessons into your life? Like this having a relationship with everything in your life as a part of yourself, as divine love. Have you been able to like remember as you go about your day these kind of things, or is it still,
you know, at the time? And I think that in general, I have integrated the basic teachings because they were so shocking, you know, when they happen, and so, you know, so undeniable that I went around to all the rabbis and asked them about my experience, and they said, oh, shh, we don't talk about such things. And I thought, well, there is nobody who can tell me that this didn't happen. You know, I mean, this is so real. And the fact that I changed all my beliefs about the purpose of life, I mean, it's been, I think I'm almost like a child experiencer because it happened so young in my life. Most of my life has been lived in the reflection of this experience. And I just don't understand other people, how they can be greedy and cold and you know, I just don't understand our culture. It just completely blows my mind how people can do the things that they do. And then I remember, oh yes, that's right, I'm an experiencer. So, not to say that I'm an angel and that I don't have conditioning and, you know, that I don't forget that sacred, that the other is the sacred, which I do. But when I reflect on my day I realize that I've done that. Oh, well, I'm going to have to go through that in my life review. I think when I got in touch with IANs and the knowledge, you know, the knowledge that there are other people in the world having the same experience, that that helped me to.
When did that happen?
In the 80s.
So how old were you when you had this experience again?
I was 20 years old. It was in 1970. And it was nearly 20 years before I found out that other people were having, you know, the literature started to come out in the late 70s, but I wasn't aware of it, or I didn't process.
It's almost like 20 years blind, 20 years awake and alone, and then 20 years with others.
Yes, yes. I was just writing something for Assist, the new organization about that's been studying integration, about the periods of my life, and I realized that it breaks down into thirds. You know, I had a third of my life not knowing any of this, being a skeptic, and a third of my life in silence, and, you know, because people would say, oh, I had a head injury and things like that, and that was just too hurtful to talk about the, you know, my beloved. And then 20 years of being connected with other experiencers and researchers and having community like that.
How about that? So you were saying before your experience, you were actually actively seeking inspiration and knowledge and were you actively seeking spirituality yet, or was it just more like trying to understand the way things are?
Well, I think spirituality was part of it. I remember reading Edgar Cayce like when I was 17. And, like, I just couldn't accept it. It was, like, so strange to me to hear him talk about reincarnation and, you know, stuff like that. I didn't believe him. It took me many years, and it took me almost another 25 years before I kind of realized that, yeah, that's the only thing that makes sense.
So, even after your experience, reincarnation wasn't something that was easy to accept.
Right. Yeah. I've had different kinds of sessions where I remembered other times and places, but I always thought that this is a little bit more complicated, that we have simultaneous lives, or that our essence or soul, parts of it, are in different people who are living at different times and places. And
I get that, but I can see how some people might not get that. So do you want to go, how do you think that is possible?
Well, because time and space are illusions. It's part of the physical reality that we perceive, and that we live as if there is time, and there is a beginning and end to things. But in the ultimate reality, there are just all these, I guess it would be like thinking of many dimensions.
Mm-hmm.
There are all these dimensions of...
great. Those are the same words I use when I talk about it. I love that you're using those words.
It would be like there would be dimensions of other choices that we didn't make in this life. So in other lives or other places, we were somebody else. We were on the receiving end of if we were on the receiving end in this life, we were on the giving end in another life of whatever it is that we're going through. And so I think that that reincarnation makes sense if you take away the idea of karma, that it's not like, you know, I created a karmic debt because I killed somebody and now it's my turn to be killed. I don't think there's a literal cause-effect relationship like that.
Mm-hmm. I totally agree. I couldn't perceive any direct line of cause and effect in my... anyway, I agree.
Because it's like the person standing at the top of the cliff has a better view of the river of using the analogy of time as a river, and all of these boats, which are all of these people in their lifetimes going through the river, you know, there's a larger picture that, you know, that your higher self or that God has of what all these adventures mean.
Yeah. I think that's a wonderful analogy to help get perspective on things. As you have been able to replay or revisit this experience after it and as you tell it, have you any other favorite analogies or thoughts that you want to expound on any part of your story? Because I know for myself, as I have gone over and over again, and, you know, I think of, oh, I could use this analogy or that analogy, you know, to help to understand it better.
An analogy that I use for the feeling of going home. It's like if you were a child who went away to summer camp, and when I was on the East Coast, people had overnight summer camps, and then you had amnesia and forgot that you had this loving family and you had a home, and that this is where you were from. You weren't from the summer camp. The summer camp was just a chapter in, you know, in your life. And then, oh, that's right. I get to go home now. And it was so joyful to be back home with, you know, what you always longed for, that you couldn't even remember, that everything you longed for was there.
Well, that's a good analogy. You bring in that innocence of childhood, too, because as a child, not being with your family and not remembering them, you don't miss what you don't know.
Right.
And then all of a sudden, all that memory is brought back to you. And since you're, you know, that innocent childhood in that necessary need for parentage is suddenly reminded to you, you know, the draw is like that much stronger. So, excellent analogy.
And I just thought of another great analogy, and now it's just it's slipping out of my head. Oh, yes. Oh, this is such a great analogy. Plato wrote about a story about the cave.
Mm-hmm.
He described these prisoners who only ever saw light reflected in shadows from inside of a cave, and they thought they were so clever that they made inferences about what they were seeing based on shadows. And then one of the prisoners was released, and he was taken up to the light. He was taken up out of the cave, and he saw the sun and grass and flowers and all of this neat stuff that you know, his companions never even imagined. And he went back to the cave and tried to explain what he saw, and they thought he was crazy. And this is like the near-death experiencer, especially years ago, the way people would react to these experiences, which were so important. That, I mean, why did we have them and remember them if we were meant to keep silent about them? Other people, it was like we were talking about another planet.
That's so great that you brought up that analogy. I just did philosophy class, and I thought it's got to be a near-death experience that Plato's talking about, because it was
right. Exactly
perfect. And so I, you know, brought it up to the teacher, and he, you know, skeptical about near-death and all that, and he just dismissed it. But I further investigated it, and it turns out that Plato did, in fact, hear a story from someone, a soldier, that had died and come back to life in the battlefield and told him about his near-death experience, which, of course, there was no name for it back then. But that analogy is a near-death experience. I knew it when I heard it the first time, and then once I investigated further, I'm like, see, I told you. I knew that. So you just nailed it. That is like one of the oldest near-death experience analogies, and philosophers are using it to talk about going from ignorance to education.
Right.
But it really is so much more than that.
Well, I think that was what inspired Raymond Moody to get his medical degree. He was a professor of Greek literature, and when he told that story, his students would come up to him and say, I had that experience. So he found that it was not unusual for people to have that experience, especially if they were ill, you know, or near death. I think his inspiration was, I know because I've heard him talk about this, that his inspiration was Greek literature.
That's so perfect, isn't it? So a near-death experience inspires the Greek, Plato.
And the other thing is that the Greeks believed in reincarnation. In that story, when he goes to the other realm, there are some ideas that are a little bit, don't really jive with what we understand, but they have to, the heroes of the Greek legends had to decide they were like lots, and they got to pick what they were going to be in their next life. And some of the heroes decided they couldn't make up their mind, so all the good lives were taken. And I think, who was that guy? who played the beautiful music, but the women tore him apart.
Ben?
I can't remember his name.
Oh.
He decided to come back as a swan. He didn't want to be a man anymore.
Oh, no, I don't know which one that is. I gotta read up on that.
But if you have Plato's Republic, it tells the whole story of, and then the three fates weave it together. One of them is necessity, and then they tighten thread, and that's it. And then you drink from the river of forgetfulness, and you start the new life, and then you're born again.
Oh yeah, that's pretty awesome. You know how, but it's like that is so part of our culture, in our educational
right.
system, but people are looking at it and studying and not really knowing what it's saying.
And it used to be that before the 20th century, ancient people studied Greek and Latin and ancient stories from the literature. When I was a child, I went to the library and I was reading and quoting mythology because I was curious about what did other people believe as a child. So I found out that I had another experience as a child that I suppressed.
Oh,
yeah.
What was that?
And that could be a whole other interview.
Okay, so you've had this challenge or whatever from childhood in the, living with people, and you can understand now maybe that they had to do what they had to do. That was their role to play. They were in survival mode. They did
what
they needed to do to survive the new environment. And so even though personally it wasn't something you feel was right for you or worked for you, but you now that you've had this experience, you can see from a bigger picture situation, have you been able to forgive and forget and move past some of the issues, or do they still things that you're still working on?
Well, that's an excellent question, and I think someone said to me that forgiving your parents is the first step in growing up at any age. It's a really big thing to do in life. It's like, as you said, my parents had their own part, their own role to play, and they held up the model of the dominant culture, and I feel like there are no victims here, and I recently remembered something from my childhood, which was that I could fly around. I could actually project and fly around my house. And like I said, it was like I'd been flying through windows all my life. Maybe I had. Maybe
so in physical or in the out-of-body?
In an out-of-body state. Okay. If I could physically fly, it felt physical at the time. And I realized that I had that experience many, many times as a kid.
Yeah.
Just amazing. And I remember thinking, I wonder if anyone can see me up here, because I was up on the ceiling and looking down at my parents and my sister, and but they didn't know. And I think that what I did was, I didn't have a technique of meditating the way, most people think of meditating. But I used to go under this one blanket that my parents had, that was, it had like a paisley design on it. And you may know that Paisley is like a fractal. Mm-hmm. It is the design of the understructure of the universe.
And I didn't know that.
Yeah. If you look up fractals, that they have on YouTube, they have pictures of what they are, and it looks. There are various ones, but Paisley is a famous design that, I mean, it must have come from a shaman who saw this. And anyhow, I would go into the fractal, and then I would leave my body.
might explain. I was doing a meditation right before our conversation, and I had a vision of a special blanket, only what I was seeing was flowers, a blanket covered with flowers. That's interesting. And you're
well, if you go into the shapes of the flowers, like a rose is a classic shape, you see these repeating patterns.
Sacred geometry, yeah.
Yes, the sacred geometry of
creation. Oh, and so
creation.
Like you're resonating with the sacred geometry even as a child.
Yes.
That's beautiful.
Was like when I got my first book, which was very recently on sacred geometry, I was like, whoa, how come nobody told me about this before? Boy, I would have loved to take that class.
Yeah, isn't it amazing?
Oh.
And it's inherent in the structure of the universe.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
And now, having had the experience of the universe...
Right.
I wanted to talk about a little bit about a little more about what did it look like to be in an illuminated universe, because I have that similar vision of trying to describe how it looks when you're out of your body or when you're in the universe, how it's light emanating from every particle.
Right. I mean, it must be that we are, like I said, we're like a horse with blinders on, so that we can do our job that we came here to do, and somehow be part of this illusion of that there is darkness, that there are, that there are spaces of nothingness. When and this is really mind blowing, how much there is, so much of the unity consciousness all around us, and this love that's all around us. But we never connect with it unless we have unless we have one of these experiences, and we can invoke that place or invoke the beings that we feel safe with to guide us to this connection. And what I have is I have an inner GPS that always steers me right. I have it's a sound that I have all the time. It sounds like crickets in the distance, and when it gets louder, that means that I'm connecting with them, and then I can like tune it like a radio station, and sometimes get messages. I can get really detailed, profound messages. I need to transcribe some of my journals, some of the stuff that I've got.
Well, that was what I was just about to ask, and you answered it before I asked it, was have you reconnected or had any more interesting experiences since throughout the years? Have you reconnected, or how has spirituality shown up in your life?
Well, It's shown up very intensely in the last few years. And maybe, I don't know if it's because of where we are galactically, you know, the whole 2012 thing, or it's just been my evolution, or maybe it's from being in Southern California where there's so many people that I can get these techniques from. But I always had this clairaudience and clairsentience, and I would kind of know when there was a call about somebody dying. It was always something that I really didn't want to know.
Mm-hmm. But, and it was just in your brain, like, I
yeah, there was just being knowing that the phone that's ringing, that's, you know, that's bad news about someone.
So claircognizance, where you just know. Now, clairsentience is when you feel something in your body or you have a sensation, and clairaudience is when you hear something, just in case people didn't know what it was.
I didn't realize for a while that clairaudience was driving me crazy, and I love to listen to music, and I would turn the radio off and I would still hear the music. and one of my spiritual friends said, you want to shut that down, you don't want to hear that. And but I found that when I started doing these meditation techniques, I would hear angels singing, and I would hear, you know, voices, and it's always speaking of love, of how much they love me. Yeah. And
what do the angels sound like? Anything that we could hear in a normal song?
Right, somewhere? Right. I mean, like the music, it's like beauty. It's what's beautiful and what inspires me, but not half as much as the other voices.
Do any of the voices?
That's such a blessing.
Do any of the voices that you hear have accents?
No.
If I did hear voices with accents, so I thought it was pretty interesting to have a guide with a particular accent. So I was wondering if anyone else had that experience.
Well, I don't know. I mean, people who channel, you know, who channel regularly, you know, that there's a process of getting your right guide. What I get is a connection with beings that I feel have not been embodied on Earth.
Mm-hmm.
It's really weird. You know, in 2009, when the stock market crashed, my guys were telling me, sell all your stocks. And, you know, I had the experts were, you know, the human experts. I thought I knew what I was doing, and I ignored the voices. And, so I realized that they know better than, you know, better than the humans, what's going to happen.
I got one of those, too. I actually followed it.
My
guy
yes.
told me to take all my money out of this particular bank, and I thought, well, there's this FDIC thing. I'm going to go online and see if there's any notices. There was no notices, but I did it anyway, and that bank went bankrupt. So I was like, okay, I'm so glad I followed that time. Yeah, it was very specific. Take your money out of this bank. I had two banks,
wow.
So the other bank I kept. So it is really good to have that. That's so then you have support, you know. Now, you didn't hear this kind of thing in the middle of your life, like definitely not in the beginning, or even when you forgot what stuff happened when you were a kid, but like after your experience, did you have clairaudience right away, or did it take a while, or
It took a little while. As I said, well,
do you think it's more? Do you? Because you mentioned the 2012 thing. Do you think humans are ascending or evolving or whatever?
Oh, I think so, because this is happening to so many people.
Do you get that resonant feeling that you
I
know?
I do. I do. Something really big is happening right now. Yeah.
So have you gotten any specific warnings from your guides about that? About what's happening now?
No, I have asked, but they haven't. Sometimes they don't answer my questions, or maybe I don't know how to listen.
Other than to get, you know.
Yeah. And it could be that we have the chance to shift the ancient prophecies of, you know, gloom and doom. I went to a lecture recently by this lady, Patricia Cota Robles.
Mm-hmm.
Have you ever heard of her?
I have.
And she saw exactly what I saw in my childhood experience, that we have misqualified energy and thought forms and emotional stuff that's used to control us, you know, that conscious people are working through to transform all of that and get rid of it. And it's like a black cloud over the earth. This is what happened in my childhood experience. I saw this, you know, this black cloud, and it was really scaring me. I didn't understand why. You know, I didn't know what the purpose was. And so she says that our goal is to change it, to question it, and to change it, because our, you know, our potential is to be the children of light that we were always supposed to have, a connection with our higher selves and with the angels around us. And the other thing, after my NDE, I saw that everyone, the only creatures in existence who don't know that they're part of the larger picture are the human beings. And there's this little spark of light inside of everyone in their heart area. And so she said there's supposed to be this threefold flame in our hearts, which are related to Father, Mother, God, and the angelic host, and you know, her whole belief system about this. And it really rings true for me, because I saw that humans had kind of walled off this flame, this heart flame. But I saw that everyone had it, no matter how negative or uncaring they were on the outside, that this flame is really, it's a part of what we are. And I think that we are, as we are having these experiences, the recent experiences, and we're awakening to the love and light within as well as all around us, we're becoming more like, more of the love and the light that is kind of our inheritance. It's just like we were told that we're paupers and we have to work and slave for 35 years at a job that we don't like, and we should be grateful for that job and, you know, in order to survive. And really, you know, we're like the kings and queens. We have everything.
We're walled off from that.
But we don't realize it.
We walled ourselves off from it.
Right. We're like, you know, I think of, I don't know if there's an actual creature like it, but I think of like the Escher painting. Did you ever see it, of this creature that keeps rolling, and it's like in the awareness is in like really small. There's like a really small face, and it just keeps rolling, and it's like that. That's what we've done with our creativity, our connectedness with the divine. We've rolled it into this tiny, tiny little nut when it's supposed to be alive and you know, this is supposed to be a key part of what we are. And what I believe about 2012 is that maybe more and more people will become psychic, because I'm really, really surprised at how much things have changed, especially this year. Mm-hmm. With the Occupy Wall Street, people questioning their values. I mean, oh, this is wonderful.
Isn't it?
And there was something I just saw on the History Channel about, you know, is there anything in Fort Knox? They're talking about, you know, did we lose our gold, and you know, in the crash? And if we did, so what? Well, we'll move past it. But you know, we need to know the truth. And it's like people are getting it. People are awakening to their. I mean, we're still a minority, but more and more of us are awakening mm-hmm. to the true values. And the values we learned in the NDE.
It was so wonderful to talk to you. I would love to talk to you again. You know, we have so much in common.
Well, I enjoyed it too. Thank you, Mary.
Thank you so much for talking to me. It was such a wonderful conversation with you, and you know, it would be great to talk again some another time, and you know, go into more. All the other stuff, there's so much more to talk about. But I really appreciate you talking to me. Thank you.